Take your Bible and turn to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, and please stand with me today as we look at faith under fire. Faith under fire, Matthew chapter 10, chapter 5, verses 10 through 12. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Father, may your word ring clear and true in our hearts. May you speak, and in so doing, draw your people even closer to you. And that one here today who has not experienced the joy of forgiveness of sin, we pray today that that one may be saved in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. We come today to the end of this series on the Beatitudes. We've been looking now for 8 weeks at learning to live like Jesus. Next Sunday morning, we're going to begin a study on the Lord's Prayer entitled Learning to Pray Like Jesus. We want to learn to live like Jesus, and we want to learn to pray like Jesus. And then we're going to look at how to love like Jesus. But next Sunday, we'll start on the Lord's Prayer. Today, faith under fire. In these final verses, Jesus teaches us what to do when we are persecuted as Christians. And we all know that in the early days of Christianity, many Christians were killed for their faith. They were fed to the lions. Nero, the emperor of Rome, would set them on fire to light the streets of Rome at night. But what we may not realize is that since the resurrection of Jesus Christ, more than 70 million Christians have been killed for their faith. 70 million. And the amazing thing about that is that half of that number, 35 million, have been killed in the last 100 years for their faith in Jesus Christ. According to the Center for the Study of Global Christianity, 100,000 Christians are killed each year in the world today. Now, I want you to think about the scope of that. 100,000 every year today. That's 11 every hour. That's about one Christian being killed every 6 minutes on this earth right now, today, for their faith in Jesus Christ. Anyone that believes being a follower of Jesus is easy is incorrect. Being a Christian in today's world is not for the faint of heart. In fact, the Bible tells us that Christians are going to face persecution. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12 says, "Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution." If we stand, now listen to me, if we stand for Jesus, we'll be opposed by the devil. Can you say amen? If we stand for Jesus, we're going to be opposed by the devil. Our faith will be under fire if we seriously live for Jesus. Now, in America, the persecution of Christians may take a more subtle form. We've not reached a point yet in this country where we're being asked to die for our faith, but nonetheless, that day may come. But now, persecution of Christians is a little more subtle than that. It can be violent oppression, as it is in many places around the world, or it can be silent oppression, as it is here in the United States. And Christians in America experience this silent oppression on a daily basis. For example, what do we do when our boss puts pressure on us to go along with something that we should not? What do we do when we're at work and we're standing around a group of people and somebody starts telling a dirty joke? Do we stand there and smile and and chuckle to get along, or do we walk away? What do we do when we go into the ballot box and we vote, and we're voting for a leader that we know supports abortion? You see, these are subtle oppressions of the devil. So this morning, I want to share with you three benefits of persecution, and then we're going to look at some things to remember when we are being persecuted. Number one, when we are persecuted, it makes us more like Jesus. It makes us more like Jesus. Jesus experienced a lot of persecution. In fact, keep your place here in Matthew and turn with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 15. John 15, and look with me at verses 18 through 20. And I want you to see here something that Jesus said. John 15, beginning in verse 18, the Lord said, "If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love its own. Yet because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep your word also." Now, Jesus was hated by a lot of people. There were some who even accused Jesus of being the devil. Can you imagine that? Some people accused the Lord of being the devil. He was loved by some. He was hated by many. And now, why was that? Well, let me try to illustrate it. When we sit in the dark for a long time, and somebody comes in and they turn on a light, what does it do to us? It blinds us for a minute. We begin to squint, and we start to rub our eyes. We try to get adjusted to the light. Now, the world is like that. The world today is just like it was in Jesus' day. The world is living in darkness. And in Isaiah 9:2, the Bible says the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. That light, of course, is Jesus Christ. And Christ came into the world and he made things uncomfortable for the people who were living in the dark, because people love darkness more than they love light. Unsaved people, they live in the darkness. And Jesus told us that as his followers, we are the light of the world. And just as the world hated him, the world is going to hate us. So when we are persecuted, we ought to consider that really to be a disguised compliment. If we are never persecuted for our faith in Jesus, it could be that we really don't have any faith in Jesus. When we live like Jesus, the world will notice our faith and they won't like it. One commentator wrote, "Persecution is not incidental to faithful Christian living, but it is certainly the evidence of it." So the first thing we need to realize is that Jesus was persecuted. And when we're persecuted, it makes us more like Jesus. Here's the second thing. When we're persecuted, it develops our faith. It makes us more like Jesus, and it develops our faith. When I was a kid, I used to wear these ankle weights. And I wore those weights because playing sports, it would make you run faster, it'd make you jump higher, it'd make your muscles develop, your leg muscles, so that you would take those weights off and at game time and you would be able to play better. Persecution is like those leg weights. It's not easy to walk around with all those weights on you, but when you do that, it develops you, and persecution is not easy. But when we go through it, it develops our faith. It not only makes us more like Jesus, but it develops our faith. In 1 Peter 1:7, Scripture says, "The genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ." So these trials and trouble that we encounter develops our faith. Here's a third thing. It brings great rewards. I want you to look with me at our text today in Matthew. Look at it again. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, I want you to circle the word persecuted in that verse and underline the word blessed. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And then in verse 11, blessed. You see it again. Mark that word, blessed. Blessed are you when they revile and, there it is again, persecute you. Mark that word, persecute again. And say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Then it says, rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so they persecuted. There it is again, three times. Mark it. The prophets who were before you. So by the time Jesus preached this sermon in Matthew, he had already faced persecution from the Pharisees and the Herodians. And he knew that the persecution he was getting ready to face was going to get much worse. And so Jesus made it very clear to all of his followers, and that includes you and me, that following him was going to be very costly. The hard truth of the gospel is that as followers of Jesus Christ, there are times when we're going to suffer for our faith. Now, if you understand me, say amen. You see, we like to push that in a back corner and never talk about it. But Jesus talked a lot about it. And he said, there will be those times when we suffer for our faith. Now, I want you to look carefully at this text. The word persecution is referred to three times, once in verse 10, once in verse 11, and once in verse 12. And the word for persecution that is used in that verse means harassment or abuse or unjust treatment. It means the ability to endure a continuous persecution if necessary. That is the price of living for Jesus. And it's talking here not only about physical persecution, it's talking about verbal persecution. Now look at verse 11. Look at it carefully. Blessed are you. What's the next word? Say it out loud. Say it again. When. Circle that word. Not if. It does not say blessed are you if. It says blessed are you when. When they revile you and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. To revile means to cast insults or to throw abusive words in someone's face. It means to mock. And before Jesus experienced all the physical abuse, Jesus was spat upon. Jesus was verbally assaulted. He was mocked. He was persecuted. And then we're told that we can not only expect verbal persecution, but we can expect false accusation. Look at verse 11 again. It says, and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Now, the persecution here gains a new intensity. It becomes even more intense. This is talking about instead of telling us to our face, instead of mocking and scorning us to our face, this is talking about slandering attacks that are being said behind our backs, which is much more difficult to take. And as difficult as this false accusation is, we can be encouraged by this promise that Jesus made in verse 12. And I want you to see this. What did he say do? What's the first word there? Rejoice. Now that seems like odd advice. Why would I rejoice? If I'm being assaulted verbally and I'm being slandered behind my back, why am I to rejoice? Well, look at what he said. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, he said. Now, look at what he's teaching us here. Jesus experienced all of these things. And he's saying here, when we are hated and when we are maligned, we are not to be sad. When we are despised by the world, we are not to be sad. In fact, he said we are to rejoice and be exceedingly glad. And that particular phrase here in this verse has a word picture behind it of a little child who is skipping happily away. Have you ever seen a kid just so happy, the kid just skipping around and maybe singing or whistling? That's the picture here. That's how Jesus says we are to be. Now, how in the world can we do that? Well, here's the way we do it. It is only possible when we keep our eyes focused on Jesus. You remember when Stephen was being stoned in the book of Acts? And the Bible says that Jesus stood in heaven. You see, Jesus was watching. Jesus knew who threw the stones. He was watching. And Jesus was watching Stephen being stoned, the first martyr of the church. And Stephen saw Jesus in heaven. And Stephen was not watching to see who threw those stones. Stephen was looking at Jesus. Stephen was worshiping Jesus. So what are we to do? We're to do the same. And when persecution comes, and inevitably if we live for Jesus, it's going to come. Here are some things we can do. Number one, don't be shocked about it. Don't be shocked. Really, we should expect it. Verse 11 says, blessed are you when, not if, but when. Now, that can mean whenever. Whenever. The idea here is not necessarily that believers will be in a constant state of persecution, but that whenever these things come into our life because of our faith, we should not be shocked by it. Don't be shocked when it comes. Jesus was not constantly opposed. In fact, there were times when he was very popular, but other times when he was greatly opposed. So don't be shocked. Second, don't be anxious. When you're being persecuted, don't be anxious about it. And the way to avoid anxiety is simply to keep your eyes on him. Don't be shocked. Don't be anxious. And then number three, don't be embarrassed when you're being persecuted. Don't be embarrassed. When we get persecuted, so often we're embarrassed by it and we want to withdraw. We want to hide because we're embarrassed. Let me tell you something, folks. Don't you ever be embarrassed for standing for the truth of Jesus Christ. Ever. Now, that's a good place to say amen. 1 Peter 4:16 says, yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. I want to share something with you this morning that will just unshackle our life. Now, I encourage you to write this down. Here it is. You do not need another person's approval in order to be happy. Did you hear that? You do not need another person's approval in order to be happy. If we learn this one thing today, it has the capacity to change our life. You see, we ought to live our life pleasing God and not man. And just because someone else may not approve of our faith in Jesus, that is no reason to be embarrassed about it. We just cannot be the person God made us to be if we are overly concerned about pleasing people more than we are concerned about pleasing God. And so who is that person in your life that you've been trying to please all these years? Who is that person? It could be your parent. Maybe you've tried for 50 years to please your parents. Maybe your parents are dead. And you still have that gnawing in your heart. But the good news is you don't have to have anybody's approval to be happy. You really don't. You are as happy as you choose to be if you focus on God rather than people who disapprove of you. And let me say something to our young people. You young folks, please listen. Don't you ever let anybody laugh you out of following Jesus. Did you hear that? Don't you ever let anybody laugh you out of following Jesus. You just stick with Jesus and you let them laugh. Just stick with Jesus. In 1 Peter, the Bible says, "For it is better if it is the will of God to suffer for doing good than doing evil." And here's the point I'm trying to make. No matter what we do in life, there's going to be somebody that won't like it. No matter what we do. And not everybody will like us, and not everybody will like what we do. So we might as well just do the thing that God likes to start with, rather than the things that other people like, because that's not going to matter whether they liked it or not when we get to heaven. Amen? We need to please God and not man. I've got a friend in this church, and I've been with this person a number of times in public situations and watched this person take a stand for Jesus Christ. And I've been so proud that I could just have shouted. And sometimes people don't like it. But you see, this person cares more about what God thinks than he cares about what people think. So don't be embarrassed when it comes to standing up for the truth. Don't be shocked. Don't be anxious. Don't be embarrassed. And last, understand the cause. Understand the cause of the persecution. Now, I want you to listen carefully as we wrap this up. The cause of persecution is not the people who are persecuting us. Understand that. The cause of persecution is the devil. The cause of persecution is the devil. That's where it comes from. In Revelation 12:10, Satan is called the accuser. That's his job. His number one job is to put us down, to mock us, to belittle us, to persecute us. Now follow me on this. The devil hates God, so he obviously hates us if we belong to God through Jesus Christ. And what he hates most of all are the children of God. So the devil hates you and me. He doesn't just hate God. He hates those of us who belong to God. Here's why. The devil can't get at God. He can't hurt God. He's not powerful enough to hurt God. He can't do it. So what does he do? He tries to hurt us. I mean, the quickest way to hurt a parent is to hurt their child. And that's what the devil tries to do. He knows he can't hurt God, so what does he try to do? He tries to hurt God's children. He tries to hurt us by getting at us. There is an unseen spiritual battle going on all around us, and all this persecution that comes from people is really coming from the devil, and they may or may not even be aware of it. And we've got to look beyond that, because people that persecute God's people are just pawns of the devil. They're just tools that the devil wants to use. Now, I want you to turn quickly, and we're almost through. Turn to the book of Ephesians in the New Testament. Ephesians, and look with me at a verse here in Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. Ephesians 6, verse 12. Scripture says, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood." What does that mean? That means against human beings. Flesh and blood, that's human beings. "For we do not wrestle against human beings, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places." You see, the devil knows it is useless to attack God, so instead he attacks those of us who follow the Lord. And all of these people today that make fun of Christians are just pawns in the hand of the devil. And if we don't have the Lord Jesus Christ in our life, we have no defense against the devil at all. I mean, without Jesus, the devil can master our moods. Without Jesus, the devil can lead us into different things, and we have no defense unless we have been born again by the Son of God and are filled with the Spirit of God. God is our defense. So let me ask you a question. What is your faith in Jesus Christ costing you today? Jesus paid a price for us. Look at that cross, that bloody cross. Jesus paid a price for us. And there is a price that we pay for him. Popularity on this earth is not part of the guarantee of being a follower of Jesus. And we've got to decide what's more important, pleasing people or pleasing the Lord. Now, in Mark chapter 8, Jesus said, "For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man also will be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with his holy angels." So God is looking for men and women of courage in an age that does not understand real courage. And what we need today is an army of brave men and women dressed in the armor of God, willing to stand with Jesus, willing to stand for Jesus, not concerned about what the world thinks, but simply concerned about what God says. That's what we need today. And God is looking for that. There was a fourth century preacher whose name was John, who preached so strongly against sin that he offended the empress and many of the church officials of his day. He was summoned to the emperor, and as he stood there before the emperor, he was threatened with banishment. He said, "Sir, you cannot banish me, for the world is my Father's house." The emperor said, "Then I will kill you." The preacher said, "You cannot, sir, for my life is hidden with Christ in God." The emperor then said, "I'm going to take away all of your earthly possessions." The preacher said, "Sir, that cannot be either. My treasures are in heaven, where none can break through and steal." The emperor said, "Then I'll drive you from man and you'll have no friends left." And that was the final desperate warning. The preacher said, "You cannot do that either. For I have a friend in heaven who has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you." So John was banished, first to Armenia and then to a faraway place on the Black Sea, to which he never arrived because he died on the way. But neither his banishment nor his death diminished his claims. The one thing he valued higher than anything else was his relationship with Jesus. And that could not be taken from him by an emperor or the devil himself or anyone else. Let's be like that man. Let's be like Jesus and understand that in this world, yes, we will have tribulation, but we can be of good cheer, because Jesus said, "I have overcome the world." And there's nothing that the devil can do to hurt us that God cannot take care of. You understand that, don't you? No matter what we go through, no matter the pressure, no matter the persecution, God knows and God cares. And God, in his wisdom, will deliver us according to his will. And in the process, God can develop our faith and make us more like Jesus. So when you're persecuted, I want you to skip like a little kid who's happy and singing a song and say, "God, use this persecution in my life to draw me to you." And all God's people said, let's stand together and we're going to pray. Our Father, we thank you that in this life, we have only one to please, and that is you. And forgive us for the times when we get so caught up, when persecution comes and we tend to worry instead of worship. And help us, like Stephen, to keep our eyes on you and not on those who are throwing stones, and to leave that up to you. And Father, we pray and trust that you will use the persecution in our lives to honor Jesus, to glorify his name. For it's in his name we humbly pray. And the church said, amen. Now here's the invitation. Has there been a time in your life when you have sincerely before God bowed your head and invited Jesus Christ to forgive your sin and be your Savior? You see, if you don't do that, you're not going to heaven. Because Jesus said he was the only way to heaven. You ask people how to go to heaven today, they'll say, be good to your neighbor. They'll say, go to church. They'll say, do good works. There's going to be a lot of people who do those things and miss heaven. Because the only way to heaven is by the blood of Jesus. And if you have not received him today, we invite you to just bow and confess your sins to Jesus Christ and ask forgiveness and invite him to come into your life and be your Savior. And if you'll do that this morning, our pastors will be here in both of our services at the front. And we invite you to come forward and let us pray with you and talk with you. If you'd like to join the church, we invite you to come forward today and let us know. If you'd like to pray, come to the altar this morning and pray. If you're being persecuted or you know somebody who may be going through persecution, there's not a better thing I know to do than get on your knees before God and pray. And we invite you to come and pray. You come as we sing.